The Lord be with you.
Also,
grace and peace to you all this morning. Good for us to be here worshiping God together as a community of faith. As we turn our hearts and minds to the worship of God, let us stand together and please join me in our call to worship. We stand in need of the presence of God.
Can be
come corrupted by our own greed. But the Lord has heard our cries and calls us forward on this journey. Open our hearts to the healing, restoring love of God. Come, let us worship God who is always with us, and let us sing our first hymn, number 157.
Good morning. My name is Hope. Though I am a rose, I'm not the rose that's supposed to be here today, but she's not feeling good. Keep her in your prayers. We want to remember Holy Week with Palm Sunday, which is March 24th, and then Maundy Thursday, we're having Agape Feast at 6 p.m. Good Friday, we're having the tenebrae service at 6. And Easter Sunday, we're having our service and our brunch. And don't forget, ladies, you can wear a hat. Another request is 1 great hour of sharing. We do this every year, and it goes to the Presbyterian Disaster Relief, the hunger program, and the self-development of people. It's a really great organization. All the money goes to wherever it's needed. There's envelopes in the pews if you'd like to contribute. If anyone else has any announcements that can come up, we do have some on the back of the bulletin you might want to look at. And I'm attending the Lakes and Prairies Synod PW Moderator meeting in April. And the Synod ladies are putting together layout kits for the Dakota Presbytery. So I have a list of whatever is on the, whatever's needed to put the kits together, and it's out in the fellowship hall. So if you'd like to donate, April 7th will be the last day because I'm leaving that week. Thank you. So I guess no one has any other announcements.
One.
Eric? Okay.
All right. Just wanted to make a quick note about worship. If you look in your insert, of course, we are doing communion today. But I also wanted to make a note. Most of you hadn't done this before, but we added a song response to the Great Prayer of Thanksgiving. And we started that Ash Wednesday, which a lot of you weren't there. But it's okay. But that's something that is great for us to have in the life of our worship and be able to respond in song while we do the liturgy and the Great Prayer Thanksgiving during communion. Thank you.
And that being said, we are having communion, and it's by intinction. And the ushers will let each pew out, each row. If you cannot come up to the altar, just raise your hand. And we have a roamer who is Dean Galloway today. He will come and serve you. We like to acknowledge visitors. If anyone's comfortable, they feel like standing up and telling us where they're from. I'll start over here. 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 No. Give each other a nod or a wave. And I like to say I'm glad the children are here today because the adults have been doing your job.
I invite the young disciples to come up. I see some young ones. And young at heart can come too if you want to join. It's fine. Well, hello. How are you all? Doing good? It's been really warm, right? Outside. Well, have you all been sick before? Yeah, it's no fun, right? So what do you do to try and feel better? Take medicine? Yeah, that's good. Like you have a cold, all stuffed up, right? And hopefully the medicine usually helps you clear out anything, right? So usually your parents probably give you the medicine so that you can take it, right? Yeah. So do you guys sometimes get sick for a long time or not that long? Yeah. Yeah, it's no fun. Especially when you're stuffed up, right? You have all the mucus, it's really gross, you want to clear it out, right? Yeah, I don't like that at all. Well, I appreciate you being willing to talk about gross stuff with me, but I think it's actually helps us think about today's scripture story, actually. So in today's scripture, Jesus is really starting his ministry. And you know what he did was to teach people to help better pay attention as far as maybe clear things up with maybe any confusion. Sometimes it didn't work. We have parables that some people don't really still understand, but it's good for us to continue to listen and hopefully figure out what God wants us to do as disciples. And Jesus also shared God's healing love with people around him. He did heal people who were sick. maybe stuffed up a little bit. But he also helped clear up things too when it came to different ways of making sure that when we worship, we are actually focused on God. Because in today's scripture, you know, we hear that Jesus actually clears things up in the temple. You know, that's where Jewish people worshiped, and they still worship in synagogues today. But at that time, it was actually kind of a marketplace. You know, people sold things. It wasn't really used and respected as a worship space to worship God. And Jesus cleared it out, actually. And kind of saying, like, you're too stuffed up. Got to clear out. I'll kind of do a little spring cleaning with the temple, right? We all like to do spring cleaning, clean our rooms, right? Yeah? No? Yeah. I mean, I didn't enjoy it either, but my mom made me, so. But it's almost like telling the temple to kind of blow your nose, like clear out things. And so sometimes our lives, what we can learn from that is our lives get stuffed up, and we kind of have to clear things out a little bit, whether we're sick or we just have to make sure that we don't have a lot of clutter, right? Kind of focus on what's important as far as loving one another. You all love each other, right? Hopefully. You love your siblings, right? Yeah? Love your siblings?
Sometimes.
Sometimes? But it's good. This story is just reminding us that we invite Jesus into our lives, and Jesus is able to help us clear up what is and make sure for us to focus on what's important, and especially with us responding to how we're supposed to love God and love others. And so that's a good news for today. So why don't we pray together and repeat after me, and everyone can join. Dear God, thank you for Jesus. Who helps us clear up, our stuffed up lives, so we can pay better attention to you. Thank you and amen. All right, you can go back to your seat.
The McClellans aren't here, but the Pattersons are going to fill in for the family of the week. When they finished praying, the place where they were meeting was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to proclaim God's message with boldness.
The challenge. Jesus showed love through his kindness to everyone. His mouth, we pray for the courage to tell our friends what God's love has done for us. We can all be witnesses to God's love through our actions towards others. The prayer. Dear Father, we pray that you will help us use the boldness so we can express God's love to our friends and they will open their eyes and see truth about God and his love for us all. Amen.
The scripture readings for today are found in Psalms 19, verse 1 through 14, and 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Listen now to the word of God. How clearly the sky reveals God's glory, how plainly it shows what he has done. Each day announces it to the following day. Each night repeats it to the next. No sound is heard, yet their message goes out to all the world and is heard to the ends of the earth. God made a home in the sky for the sun. It comes out in the morning like a happy bridegroom, like an athlete eager to run a race. It starts at one end of the sky and goes across to the other. Nothing can hide from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect. It gives new strength. The command of the Lord are trustworthy, giving wisdom to those who lack it. The laws of the Lord are right, and those who obey them are happy. The commands of the Lord are just and give understanding to the mind. Reverence for the Lord is good. It will continue forever. The judgment of the Lord are just. They are always fair. They are more desirable than the finest gold. They are sweeter than the purest honey. They give knowledge to me, your servant. I am rewarded for obeying them. None of us can see our own errors. Deliver me, Lord, from hidden faults. Keep me safe also from willful sins. Don't let them rule over me. Then I shall be perfect and free from the evil of sin. May my words and my thoughts be acceptable to you, O Lord, my refuge and my redeemer. And from 1 Corinthians, for the message about Christ's death on the cross is nonsense to those who are being lost. But for us who are being saved, it is God's power. The scripture says, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and set aside the understanding of the scholars. So then, where does that leave the wise or the scholars, or the skilled debaters of this world? God has shown that this world's wisdom is foolishness, for God in his wisdom made it impossible for people to know him by means of their own wisdom. Instead, by means of the so-called foolish message we preach, God decided to save those who believe. Jews want miracles for proof, and Greeks look for wisdom. As for us, we proclaim the crucified Christ, a message that is offensive to the Jews and nonsense to the Gentiles. But those whom God has called, both Jews and Gentiles, this message is Christ, who is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For what seems to be foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and what seems to be God's weakness is stronger than human wisdom. May God bless the receiving of this word.
Friends, in our time of confession, we know that God's love is not hidden from us, but turns to us full of grace and mercy. God does not turn away from us, but reaches out to gather us together as brothers and sisters. So let us, in humility and confidence, confess our sin to God and one another. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Patient Lord, we have cluttered the temples of our lives with so many unnecessary things that have blocked out your healing words of hope and mercy. Forgive us when we have been so preoccupied with these things that we have not listened to your words and followed your ways. Clear away our fears and frustrations. Give us clean hearts and spirits. Help us to be confident in your mercy and transformational love. These things we offer in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Friends, rejoice. You are forgiven. Let the clutter of your life fall away and be replaced by the love of God in Christ Jesus. This is the good news of the gospel. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now let us stand and sing our next hymn, number 166. Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. Please listen for God's word to you. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people settling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Gracious God, our way in the wilderness, guide us by your word through these 40 days. And minister to us with your Holy Spirit so that we may be reformed, restored, and renewed. And, O Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. What do you think of table-turning, animal-driving, whip-carrying Jesus? What do you imagine set him off that day? And what do we do with this story? There was a time when I heard this story as being mostly about anger. Jesus got angry. I get angry. So it's okay to get angry if you're angry about the right thing. Maybe, but I think there's more to the story than that. I wonder if what we see Jesus doing might not be an expression of his deepest compassion for life, for the temple, for the world, and for you and me. There was a time when I thought Jesus was upset about the animals and the money changers in the temple. Maybe. But again, I think there's more to the story than that. I don't think Jesus was surprised by the animals and the money changers. He grew up as a faithful Jew going to the temple. He didn't show up this day and say, "Wow, there are animals and money changers in here. I didn't know that. This is wrong." The animals and money changers had always been there. That's how the system worked. It was business as usual for them to be there. Business as usual meant changing Roman coins to temple coins, purchasing an animal, and offering a sacrifice. I think business as usual is the issue. The animals and money changers are not the problem. They are the symptom that something else is going on. I think Jesus went to the temple that day for one purpose and with one intention: to throw out and overturn business as usual. There are times when we need the tables of our life to be overturned and the animals thrown out. It's just so easy to fall into the trap of business as usual. Haven't there been times in your life when you realized that business as usual was costing you your life? Haven't there been times when you realized that business as usual was leaving you spiritually bankrupt? Haven't there been times in your life when you were keeping on, but nothing changed? Business as usual can happen anywhere. In friendships, in marriages, in parenting, in work, church. It's all habits and routines we fall into that cause us to sleepwalk through this world. We look, but we don't see. We listen, but we don't hear. We speak, but don't say anything. It happens whenever we push the autopilot button and life becomes mechanical. We just go through the motions. We show up, but we're not really there. Have you ever smiled that I'm good and everything is fine kind of smile, but behind that smile was emptiness? You felt hollow and your heart was breaking. That's carrying on with business as usual. Or maybe you wake up in the morning and you're as exhausted as you were when you went to bed the night before. Business as usual. Have you ever felt like you were just not yourself? Nothing seemed right. Boredom overcame creativity. There was no enthusiasm, no wonder, no imagination, no play. It was just business as usual. Maybe it's time to do some spring cleaning. Sometimes we look at life and the world, and it just all seems vain. Is this all there is to me in my life? What have I accomplished? Who am I? We're busy, but not really getting anywhere. There's no death, depth, or meaning. Just business as usual. There are thousands of reasons and ways in which we fall into business as usual. There's one thing, however, that I keep coming back to: forgetfulness. Business as usual is born of forgetfulness. It happens every day when we forget the original beauty of our creation. It happens whenever we forget the God-given dignity of humanity, ours and another's. It happens whenever we forget that we have been created in the image and likeness of God. It happens whenever we forget that after creation, God saw everything that God had made, and indeed, it was good. It happens whenever we forget the grace and possibilities bestowed upon us at our baptism. And it happens when we close ourselves to the future. It happens anytime we forget that Jesus turns the water of our lives into wine. It happens anytime we forget that the Word became flesh and lived among us. It happens every time we forget that we have all received grace upon grace. And to borrow a phrase from our Muslim brothers and sisters, it happens whenever we forget that God is closer to us than our own jugular vein. When we forget that we are a temple of God, the very residence of the Holy Spirit, life can easily become a series of transactions. Relationships and intimacy are lost. Priorities get rearranged. Our world is small. And making a living replaces living a life. And the life we have become a marketplace rather than a place for meeting the holy within us and one another. And it's business as usual. That's what Jesus is overturning and driving out of the temple, his own spring cleaning. When the authorities ask for a sign from Jesus for what he is doing, he says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Of course, the authorities don't understand. They are thinking a stone and mortar temple, but Jesus is talking about a flesh and blood temple. The temple he is talking about is a temple of human life. In 3 days, what does that make you think of? What happens on the third day? Resurrection, a new life, a new beginning, a new creation, a rebirth. Not business as usual. Over and over again, Jesus interrupts, disrupts, and overturns and throws out business as usual. It was no longer business as usual for the Samaritan woman. She is no longer the woman who had five husbands and lives with a sixth man. She is a well of living water. It was no longer business as usual for the man who lay paralyzed on his mat. He took up his mat and walked. It was no longer business as usual for the 5,000 empty and hungry people. They left the mountainside full and satisfied. It was no longer business as usual for the woman caught in adultery. "Neither do I condemn you," Jesus said. "Go your way." It was no longer business as usual for the man blind from birth. "One thing I do know," he said, "though I was blind, now I see." It was no longer business as usual for the 4 days dead Lazarus. He came out of that tomb. If those stories tell us anything, they tell us that we are not intended to live business as usual. It's too small for our lives. Lent is a season that invites us to look at the ways our life has become business as usual, to make changes, to clean out, and prepare for a new life, a new day, the third day. I wonder what business as usual looks like in your life today. What tables need to be overturned? What animals need to be driven out? And what does the temple of your life need today? And what are you willing to do about that? The poet David White ends his poem "Sweet Darkness" with these lines: "Anything or anyone that does not bring you alive is too small for you. Business as usual is a life too small for you, the temple, and the world." All honor and praise be to God. Amen.
Here I am, Lord.mp3.
Friends, let us now stand together and affirm our faith using the brief statement of faith of 1983 printed in your insert. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus." With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Now, friends, let us sing the first two verses of hymn number 223.
Thank you.
seated. Friends, I just forgot to mention before we started you can actually sing the responses in your hymnal 552, 553, and 554. Friends, as we come to this table of thanksgiving and remembrance, we remember that this table is for all of us, near and far, high and low, east and west and north and south. This table is for all of us, but is not our table. It is the Lord's table. For all of us, it is a table of grace. So come and take your place at this table, where you are welcome, you are invited, and you are called. For remember that blessed are you who hunger for justice, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who thirst for righteousness, for you will drink deeply of the cup of joy. Blessed are you who yearn for reconciliation, for you will find peace. And blessed are we, for Christ calls us to the table, where there is room for everyone and plenty for all. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to offer you our thanks and praise, O God, our Lord, Creator and Redeemer. In your wisdom, you made all things and sustained them by your power. You formed us in your image to love and serve you. You fed us with heavenly food in the wilderness and satisfied our thirst from desert springs. On a holy mountain, you gave us your law to guide us in your way. You spoke through prophets, calling us to turn from our willful ways to new obedience and righteousness. You sent your only Son to be the way to eternal life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the faithful from every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He took upon himself the weight of our sin and carried the burden of our guilt. He shared our life in every way, and though tempted, was sinless to the end. Baptized as your own, he went willingly to his death and by your power was raised to new life. In his dying and rising, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And with thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Guide us through the desert of life. Quench our thirst with the living waters. Satisfy our hunger with the bread of heaven. And give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, creator and sustainer of all. Glory to you forever and ever. And now we pray. On earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, do you remember the Lord Jesus on the night of his arrest? He took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Whenever you eat this, do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. Friends, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, of course, we'll do our communion by intinction. There'll be two stations and you'll come up. Ushers will have you usher you forward, and you will take a piece of bread and dip it into the cup. And if you're not able to come forward, there will be a roamer who will be able to feed you at your seat. Friends, the table is set. All is prepared. Will the servers please come forward? Friends, please join me in our communion prayer. Faithful, generous, abiding God, we give you thanks for the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation. May the taste of this meal linger so that we will be strengthened in our Lenten journey. Give us courage to hear what may seem harsh so we can find a deeper relationship with you. To your Son's glory, amen. And now let's stand together and sing the last four verses of number 223. You may be seated. Friends, in this time, let us share of our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. what we offer today, our money, our faulty steps, our brokenness, our leftovers, our hope, our risking, our lives. Bless and transform all that we offer and all that we hold back, that new life may be ours to celebrate and share. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, friends, go forth with God at your side, seeking goodness and compassion. Bring the words of hope and peace to all whom you meet. Go in peace. Amen.